This is going to be an amazing lecture. You can tell already how much fun it's going to be. I'm Melissa Franklin. I'm running this lecture series. This is the last public lecture in the Science Center for this year. You can find all the videos of the lectures we've had in this series on the Physics Department website, if you want to go there. And so you can, or you can just look for Research Lectures Science Center, and you'll find them. So if you fall asleep in the middle of this one, you can catch up in a couple of weeks later. Tonight's speaker is, for the first time this year, is my colleague in my department, in the physics department. He is an amazing experimental physicist. And that's something I love to say and love to introduce to you. I'm sure you've heard a lot about theory people, but there's some people like Markus Greiner who have fantastic hands, which means basically that they're brilliant and they actually build things also. Markus got his PhD in Munich, and amazingly enough, he got a PhD thesis award, the very first ever, from the American Physical Society. So that's got to be impressive. Then he came to Colorado and went to GILA, which is a place where they do amazing physics. And then finally, we got him here as an assistant professor. And I have to say that Markus, when he first came, didn't have a lab, so they gave him a trailer out in the law school quad. And he was able to do, somehow he was able to do really good physics in that trailer. I don't know if you're talking about any of that trailer physics. We now just call it trailer physics, which is what he does. Yeah. Anyhow, Markus is now a professor in our department. He's had a meteoric rise. And if you ever go to his lab, if you're ever lucky enough to go to his lab, it's just mind-bogglingly beautiful. And very, very small. But now he's getting a bigger lab. Anyway, I said I wouldn't talk for 10 minutes. It's just I'm so excited to introduce Markus Greiner tonight.
Melissa, thank you very much for the way too kind introduction. And so I'm really excited to tell you a little bit about our quantum Lego, essentially, or about how we really are able now to put together quantum systems, kind of like putting together Lego pieces. So we create really clean, really well-controlled systems that behave totally quantum mechanically. And we are able to build more and more complex, more and more interesting things with that. And so I would like to take you on a tour through kind of how does this work? What are these Lego pieces like? How do we put them together? And what can we build with it? What can we investigate with it? I also apologize. I know everyone is eager for warmer weather in spring. Actually, today wasn't bad. I will also be talking about the coldest temperatures in the universe. So, in the known universe, sorry. Because that's what it takes. That's what we need to create these quantum systems that we want to study. We have to be as cold as possible. So cold, ultra-cold atoms. This story goes back kind of 90 years when Einstein and Bose realized that under certain circumstances, a lot of particles would go into the same quantum state called a Bose-Einstein-Condensate state. We will get to that later, but the important part is that this was a theoretical idea for a long time, but in 1995, Eric Cornell, Carl Wieman, and Wolfgang Kettler were able to realize such a state in the lab with cold atoms, by laser cooling atoms, and so that's where the story began. And I'm kind of the next generation who started a few years later with that, but really to bring these systems to the next level where we have even much more complex and complicated systems that we can realize. So how cold is cold? What's the coldest thing you know or kind of seen? Well, besides a Boston winter, one thing that's really cold is liquid nitrogen, right? This is, you might have seen this in school or so. So if you have liquid nitrogen, so yeah, I can pull out a little bit probably. Oops. So you see how this works. It's pretty cold. It's also in here. It boils. So liquid nitrogen is what air is mostly made of. And if you cool it to really low temperature, then it actually becomes a liquid, just like a water vapor turns into liquid water, right? So let's see, what can we do with this? This is way colder than what you normally deal with in a freezer. So I put this flower in here and see what happens if we freeze this flower. Well, what you expect, of course, is all the water in that flower freezes immediately, and so the flower still looks kind of the same, but it will behave very differently. Let's see. So this is boiling, right? Because the heat comes up and it bubbles up, but it's not water vapor that boils; it's nitrogen gas coming out there from the liquid nitrogen. And I'm just gonna try it. So it's a nice flower, looks just the same, right? But it's probably really brittle, let's see. Oh, I'm sorry. So this is, or this used to be a rose. Okay, we also have a little piece, so this is like a little bit of clay, a little bit of it's like really soft, right? You can pull it apart, and I can take a piece. There's a piece in here. If it's this cold, and I take a hammer, let's see what it does. It's like glass. It gets really hard. Okay, so this is cold. Well, unfortunately, it's actually not cold at all on our scales, because what we do in the lab is we go really cold. So here's a scale. This is a logarithmic scale. So each line is one order of magnitude, or a factor of 10 colder. This is room temperature here. This is 10 times colder, 100 times colder, 1,000 times colder. That's absolute zero temperature, as you know, at minus 273 Celsius. And you can't get exactly to absolute zero temperature, but you can get very, very close to absolute zero temperature. Let's see, if you have liquid nitrogen, we are just a little bit colder. This was liquid nitrogen. And liquid helium at 4 Kelvin, like 4 degrees Celsius above absolute zero temperature, is much colder than that. But we are still far away from as cold as you could be. So the logarithmic plot means that you can get closer and closer and closer to the absolute to absolute zero temperature, and each time it's 10 times smaller. Okay, and so what we do in our experiment, we are tens of picokelvin away from absolute zero temperature, so about 13 orders of magnitude colder than room temperature. And if you compare this to the other end, we are just as cold as these newest gigantic supercolliders are hot, meaning we are as the energy that our atoms have is as many orders of magnitude lower than what you have at room temperature than the energies that these supercolliders create when they smash together particles to create, to do this high energy physics. So you're just as cold as the LHC is hot. Or another comparison, if you had a thermometer that reaches, where the scale reaches from here all the way to the moon, and here we have absolute zero, and at the moon we have room temperature, okay? So just a regular thermometer, it starts here, but the room temperature reading is at the moon, then we are only the width of a hair away from absolute zero temperature on that scale. 13 orders of magnitude. How do we get cold? Well, we deal with gases, so in a gas, at room temperature, you can't tell, but actually the atoms fly around with about the speed of sound all the time. This is why what actually gives it the speed of sound, okay? So they fly around, bounce into each other, and what we have to do to cool a gas is to slow down the atoms. And how do we slow them down? We can actually use light, we can use laser light to slow them down. Here you see atoms slowed down. This is a cloud and a magneto-optical trap, and you see how slowly the atoms fly apart. Normally they would fly with the speed of sound in an instant. Here they fly slowly, and this is already very cold, about 50 microkelvin, okay? The trick here is that if the atoms fly towards a laser beam, they scatter photons, and the photons push the atoms, and so you can create a drag, like a molasses, and the atoms get slower and slower, and that gets us colder. Unfortunately, this is still by far not cold enough. This is 50 microkelvin, so we are already about six orders of magnitude colder than room temperature. The next step is we have to work in the dark without the laser light in a magnetic trap. There, the trick is that we can do evaporative cooling. So these are atoms in a trap that bounce around, and if we slowly lower the depth of the trap, then the hottest atoms can always escape. But the hottest one take away more than average energy, so the rest gets colder, colder, colder. And you see the blue temperature means cold. And this works quite nicely. In the end, we get something called a Bose-Einstein condensate. So that's the idea. We have a magneto-optical trap in a gas. The whole thing happens inside a vacuum chamber so that you are well isolated from the environment in a very dilute gas. You slow down the atoms, and then you use this additional evaporative cooling to create these cold temperatures. So why do we do that? I mean, you would think at absolute zero temperature, or close to absolute zero temperature, everything is at standstill, and that sounds pretty boring. The exciting thing is that at these cold temperatures, quantum mechanics takes over in a really profound, very clean way. And so that's what I will be talking about now. Okay. In order to understand that, well, quantum mechanics means that matter behaves wave-like, like a wave. Okay. So what are waves? What kind of waves do we know? We know water waves, for example. Let me actually show you an example here. So here I have a water tank where I can create water waves. And if I increase, if I shake here, here are two sources. And then I can see how the wave, how water waves propagate here, right? I will leave this on for 1 minute. So there are water waves, or other waves that you know are sound waves that also happen inside a material, inside air. Like you have waves in the density of the air, and these are the sound waves that you hear when I talk to you. So these are waves in matter, but this is just you have a wave-like motion of the particles inside the matter. Other waves, so these waves that travel inside matter, they couldn't exist in space, for example, because in space there is no matter. But waves that can exist in space with nothing else are electromagnetic waves. There are radio waves at long wavelengths and at much shorter wavelengths and much higher frequencies. You have light waves, and as you know, depending on the color of light, you have different wavelengths. Okay. So the waves I will be talking about, they behave a lot like these waves, okay? For example, one thing that these waves can do is that they can actually, it's called interfere, meaning that two waves can, they can add up or cancel out. If I have one wave that looks like this, and at the same place I add another wave that also looks like this, then I just have to add them up, and together they will look like twice as high. I messed up. Together, they will look like a wave that's twice as large. But if one wave is like this and the other one is opposite, right, then they will just cancel out. Okay. So one wave plus one wave can be either a stronger wave or nothing or weaker wave. Okay? That's called interference, and that's a fundamental wave effect that if waves come together, they can interfere. Oops, what did I do here? What happened? And so but the waves I will be talking about are now matter waves. So what is that? What is matter wave? The thing is that under certain circumstances, or like matter, if matter moves, it like normally in everyday life you can totally like neglect that. But if matter moves, this motion is also described by a wave. But it's a quantum mechanical wave. It's a matter wave, a de Broglie wave. It's a wave that tells you the probability of finding a particle at a certain point. Okay. Like here is a sketch of that. So if an atom moves, what it really is it's a little wave packet. Okay. And the wave packet is strongest here and weaker here. And the strength of the wave everywhere tells you the probability that if you try to detect an atom, that you would actually find it at that position. Okay. That's a matter wave. Why don't we see that in everyday's life? So the thing is that if, for example, an atom moves fast, like in air or at room temperature or at any reasonable temperature, then the wavelength, real quick. Here you can see how waves add up and cancel out. And I can turn it off. At room temperature, the wavelength is very, or at higher speeds, this wavelength is very, very short, and the wave packet is very, very short. And that means that this wave packet that describes the atom is much smaller than the atom itself. So it doesn't play a role at all. Like, it's a little wave packet. The atom is, the position of the atom is fundamentally uncertain. It's described by this little wave. But since that's smaller than the atom itself, it's really irrelevant. Okay? You can perfectly think of an atom normally as a point-like particle that flies around, bounces into another one, like a little ball. Even much more so, the wavelength also depends on the mass. If you have something bigger, like a soccer ball, this wavelength is even much smaller. So it's negligible by 100 orders of magnitude or so. Okay? So for everything big and classical, it doesn't play a role. But if we now take our atoms and cool them down so much and slow them down so much, then this wave packet gets larger and larger. And that you see here. So initially, totally classical gas like balls flying around. But as we cool it down, we have to think of this wave nature. And very quickly, we get a situation that's really like this in this picture. This is the atom, OK? And it's really smeared out. This wave delocalizes it. It's simultaneously at multiple places at the same time, kind of smeared out over this finite area, right? And that happens at these cold temperatures. Ultimately, you can imagine if you have many atoms and their wave packets overlap, then of course something weird could happen. You can't distinguish the atoms anymore if you have just waves overlapping, and that's exactly what a Bose-Einstein condensate is. I will get back to that. So we will explore this quantum nature that's really dictated by these waves in this talk. But let me first tell you a little bit more about our atoms, our ultracold atoms, and how we can use them as Lego pieces to put things together. So what do we do with our atoms? We put them into a so-called optical lattice. An optical lattice, this is like a potential. It looks like an egg crate or like this kind of piece of foam with these little holes. And our atoms can move inside that. They can actually only be at these certain positions. And they can hop around here. So they can hop around in this lattice. So each time, we can only find an atom at these discrete locations. That's what we can do by creating such a pattern by light. It turns out if you shine far detuned light onto atoms, that acts like an optical tweezer. It creates a force for the atom. You need, in order for light to create a force for anything, you need extremely strong light and the particles need to be really light. But that's the case, of course, if you have atoms, they are light, and with laser beams you can make strong light, so that's all fine. Let's have a look how this works. Here's a video that Ted Hensch, my thesis advisor, did. So here, these are light patterns. They're actually created by interfering laser beams. And now we can put little polystyrol particles in water. So this is not atoms now, single atoms. This is much easier. This is just little plastic balls in water. But even for that, you can see that light can create forces. So this is used an optical tweezer. So here we see these little plastic balls, and they're attracted to the light. They go where the light is brightest, OK? And if you create a more complex pattern, like this cross interference that you see now, then you can really see how they hop into these lattice sites, really just like these marbles in this foam. Okay. Now, in our case, we actually use these atoms. We do the exact same thing with the atoms, with the very cold atoms. So they're in, we say, the lowest bend of this lattice potential. And they can hop from lattice site to lattice site. Another thing we can do, and that's what we developed new here at Harvard, this is that we can take photographs of the atom. We can take a snapshot of the atom, and we call this the quantum gas microscope. The idea is we really want to see each individual atom in there. And in order to make that possible, we built this quantum gas microscope. You see that we trap two-dimensional grids of these atoms, a two-dimensional quantum gas in such an optical lattice, but this is in the focus of a very special microscope that we built. And we can then shine light onto these atoms, and the atoms fluoresce, and we can collect this fluorescence and see the individual atom. It sounds really simple, but it's actually not, because you have to, I mean, you can imagine these atoms are so cold, and they can only be held by this light because they are this cold. But as soon as you shine light on them and have to fluoresce, they heat up, and you have to cool them again, and it's a long story. But essentially, so this is what the heart of the experiment looks like. So here's a little two-dimensional quantum gas below this glass surface. There's a very good vacuum inside this thing. And on top of this, what you don't see is the very high-resolution microscope objective. Now, this microscope doesn't look like a regular biology microscope or so. I want to show you how this microscope looks. And so we're going to try to do a little lab tour. So we actually have a live Skype connection to my lab. So let's see if that works. Can you guys hear me? Hello. hi, guys. So this is Philip, Eric, and Rajibul in the lab right now, because I want to try to show you a live picture of the atoms in our quantum gas microscope. OK, guys, you can show us the lab. So here's a control center where we have all the computers where they were sitting. And now you can see, so these are optical tables. These are, hold it steady, so yeah, get right. So these are big, these are big optical tables with tens of lasers on there. Each of these little things are optical elements, little mirrors, lenses. And there are two tables. One just contains all the laser, and this table is where the quantum gas microscope is, in the middle of all this mess. But it's not mess. It's really like each of these little pieces you see here is a very well, very finely adjusted mirror that sends light beams, hundreds of light beams, back and forth. And in the center of this is this little glass cell that I was just showing you. And right, so here you see a mirror here below here. And this is where we image then. Here comes the light out for imaging. But we send laser beams from all directions into this. OK, guys, let's see if we can turn off that light and catch some atoms.
OK, let's try.
See if that works. So this is the control computer and so on. So the first thing you might see is a magneto-optical trap. So on this monitor, we will see this magneto-optical trap that you saw in the beginning already, where we can capture atoms here. You see this cloud of atoms being captured. And now it's off. Now we do this evaporative cooling that I was showing you, where we constantly lose the hot atoms. Then we load it into the optical lattice. We can do some physics then. And at the very end, we take one snapshot. So let's look on this monitor and see in a few seconds we should, this cooling takes a while, and then we should be able to take a picture. Yeah, there you go. Okay, so look, each of these green dots is exactly one atom. Okay, each of these green dots is one atom. Oh, now we can see it. Okay, as some more pictures, you will see this more in the talk. Okay, guys, thank you very much. You can come over here now. Fantastic. Good, so here's another picture like that. And you can see that so each dot is one individual atom. But it's not just an atom. It's actually an atom that's ultra cold. That is it in exactly one quantum mechanical state. It's in the lowest band of the lattice at that position. We can zoom in, and then you see this underlying grid here. So you see these atoms are really arranged in an optical lattice. They are randomly occupying lattice sites right now, just like the marbles in this, just like the marbles here. But yeah, but overall, in this case, these are about 10,000 atoms that we can image with perfect fidelity in a single shot. We can even take movies. Here you see atoms tunneling around, hopping around in real time. This is a real-time movie. But I must say, actually, so this isn't really quantum mechanics, because once we watch it, as you will see in a minute, as we watch it, the atoms constantly give away their position, and so there is no quantum uncertainty anymore. So we have to do our experiments in the dark, and just in the very end, we take one snapshot. We take one picture of the atoms. So what can you do if you have such atoms in an optical lattice? So the first thing we did, of course, is this here. So you see this movie. So this is the first quantum computer game. I don't know, probably the younger students probably don't even know what this is, but everyone at least as old as me remember the times of green monitors, right? Okay, no, I'm kidding. So what we really do is we use these atoms now essentially as Lego pieces to put together these artificial quantum systems, like and engineered materials. So there are all kind of different things you can do with that. For example, we have studied a superfluid Bose-Hubbard model, easing spins. I will talk about this a little bit in a while. But there are many ideas out there, and many groups all over the world are now working towards really creating exciting new states of matter here. But let's go back a step. So what are these Lego pieces? How do these atoms behave if they are this cold in the optical lattice? The first thing is that they, the atoms tunnel, the first thing we should discuss is how do the atoms move in the optical lattice? The thing is they don't move classically like the marbles. They tunnel from one lattice site to another. So they can hop left or right, okay? They tunnel. But what does that mean, they tunnel left and right? Is this, so one possibility is it could be kind of like this this pegboard here, where I put marbles in. So at each peg, the marble has to decide, do I go left or right, okay? And it can either go left and right. And so if you put a marble in here, you can see that it finds its way down, and it's totally random. It's totally random where it ends up, because it has many decisions to make on the way. So let me put some marbles in here and see how they end up in that board. You can see the marbles here. Each of them follows a random track. Uh, And so what you get at the end of the day is a distribution. So if each time the marble hits a peg, it can decide 50-50 to go left and right, then you get kind of a pattern like this that has most weight in the center. This is called a Gaussian distribution. Here you see many, many tracks, and if you plot them all randomly, the overall distribution is a Gauss. It's a diffusive motion, and you have this kind of effect you have in many things, like in finances and in biology and so on. And the reason I'm showing this to you is that this is not what our atoms do at all. Because this is totally classical. This is like the idea that each time you throw a coin and then at each peg you go either left or right. What do our atoms do? Our atoms, they also kind of have this 50-50 decision, do I tunnel to the left well or do I tunnel to the right well? But they do that quantum mechanically, and that means they do both. They tunnel left and right simultaneously. Okay. And afterwards, they are left and right simultaneously, kind of. They are in a superposition of being left and right. Okay, and that is described by a matter wave. So we can do an experiment now. We can use our atoms. We start on one lattice side here, and then we let them tunnel. And let's see what happens. So I have to describe this now with this matter wave in order to understand what's happening. So, as I said, I start with one atom on one side, so this is equivalent to a matter wave that is localized on one side. This wave tells you where you're likely to find the atom. The height of this wave here tells you the probability to find the atom at that position. Okay. So at first, I know it's here, so there's only a wave here. But if I then let the atom go, see, it will go to both sides, or the wave, the matter wave, that describes the motion of the atom will go to both sides. Okay. So we'll be left and right here. Okay, and what that means is that the atom is really a little bit left and a little bit right. It is in a superposition of left and right, or it could have even stayed at the same position, but it could not be here or here, because here you have this destructive interference. The waves cancel out. Atom plus atom is no atom, essentially. And right, so this is weird, right? But the amazing thing is that this is really what quantum mechanics is about. Okay, it all makes sense in the end, because once you look. And look means once you scatter light off the atom, or once you have a way to obtain information about where the atom might be, at that moment, this is, for example, happening by shining light, and then the atom fluoresces, like you saw earlier, and we can tell where it is. If you shine in light, then the wave function collapses, we say, and you just find the atom at one position. And where you find it is described by this matter wave that we had earlier. The probability to find the atom on this lattice side is just proportional to the matter wave intensity at that side. Okay, so let's do the experiment again. We again create this atomic superposition, but we have to start from scratch. Okay, we again do the superposition. We again shine light, and this time we find it here. Okay, so it's this probabilistic interpretation of quantum mechanics. You have an atom delocalized as a matter wave over many places, but then once you look, you find it at one position. And the matter wave tells you where you find it. Okay, so right. So we can do this in the experiment. This is the random this random walk of an atom that we do. And then we shine light, collapse the wave function, and let's look how the statistics looks like. So here, we found it at this position. The next time, we find it at this position. Then the next time here, the next time here. Like, we can repeat the experiment from scratch over and over again. And in the end, if we repeat this many times, instead of creating this Gaussian pattern that we had here, we now create a pattern that characterizes our wave function. So this is very theoretical, right? Because normally this never happens if you actually have atoms, because atoms constantly give away information about their position, and at that moment, the wave function collapses. You have to isolate these atoms incredibly well. Super good, the best vacuum you can do, the coldest temperatures you can make. If you do all of that, then the atom behaves like this. Then the atom, right. I should mention that what's easier to see is electrons, and in electron microscopes, for example, you have seen that. Also, if you know, of course, you know chemistry. Electrons are in orbitals there. This is the same matter waves, right? So the orbital of an electron describes the probability to find the electron at a certain position. Once you actually would measure in an atom where the electron is, you've always find it at one position, but this orbital tells you where you might find it. Okay. Okay. So let's try the experiment. Okay. Here we have prepared this. It's a raw image picture. You see a row of atoms here. And we have created a situation where the atoms can tunnel left and right, but not up and down. So they can move only left and right. So let's start the atoms, okay? And you see how they now spread out here, okay? So each picture is an individual run, right? We always have to start from scratch. Once we take a picture, we have to discard the atoms and start over. But then we take a picture like this, and in this case, the atom in this row we detected here, and this we detected here. This pattern, the probability to find an atom at a side is given by this, is given by the shape of the matter wave that is expanding in that lattice. Okay. Good. So the here you can see if you now plot versus time the position, then you see this characteristic shape. So this looks very different from, you can see this characteristic shape. And we can compare this to theory. So here's how this evolves over time, right? And we can compare this to theory. See, it looks exactly what you would expect for a perfect quantum particle. And so that means our cold atoms are amazingly perfect quantum particles. And it looks totally different from what a classical particle would do. Then you would expect this Gauss. One difference is that this is a Gaussian, this Gaussian shape only spreads out diffusive very slowly. This is ballistically very fast. This has application in, there are now experiments that seem to prove that in biology, there can be effects in photosynthesis where you want to create electronic where you want to transfer electronic excitation from an antenna complex where, if a plant collects light, it catches a photon that creates an electronic excitation, and that has to get quickly before it decays to a place where it can then make a chemical reaction. This transport seems to be somewhat coherent, so there is a bit of this quantum speed up that you see present even in biological system. But this is electrons, not atoms. This is, and even there, it's very borderline. So with these cold atoms, we get a much cleaner version of this. Okay. Okay, but how do we know it's really quantum? I mean, kind of like I showed you, yeah, the wave spreads out, and this all makes sense, kind of, but do we have a better proof? Well, let's try the following. Let's try to tilt this lattice a little bit, okay? What would that happen? What would you expect classically? Right, so what would you think if I just tilt this to the side here and put marbles in, they would just end up on that side, right? Okay, not so for the quantum system. If I tilt this and I let the time evolve, so I place an atom here, then the matter wave evolves totally symmetrically, it goes left and right. Okay, that's the first thing. It doesn't go down at all. Up and down is all the same. It just spreads out still symmetrically like for the quantum walk. But more important, it will actually refocus if you let it go. If it'll go out, like if you tilt it, if you have it straight, it just goes out forever. If you tilt it, it goes out and comes back. Okay? This is called a Bloch oscillation, and this periodically happens. It goes out and comes back. Okay? And then it goes out again and comes back. This periodically should happen, okay? Well, let's see what happens if you do this with atoms. So here again, we have prepared our atoms on a row here, one atom per side. If we let time run, now indeed the atoms go out, right? And remember, each of these pictures is one like we just take one picture at the end of this walk each time, and each if you see a new picture here, this is always a new experimental run. Well, based on what we saw here in the wave function, we would now expect that the atoms get together again. But this would really have to be quantum, because at this point, if you have these atoms classically positioned here, if they're really just at this place, and this whole thing is just a tilted plane, there's no way the atom would know where to go back to, right? If this is what the atoms are, if you just place atoms like this on a board and you tilt the board, they would never refocus to one side. But let's see what happens if I do this in the experiment. If I continue the time, they go perfectly back to the same side. Okay. Let me do this again. So this really means that the atoms have to, the atoms are really delocalized in this lattice. The atoms are really in this quantum superposition characterized by this wave. The atoms are really in all these places at the same time. And they are so perfectly, okay, with very good coherence, because otherwise there would be no way that they could come back again to that same place. Once this quantum state is collapsed, like once I take a picture, I collapse this quantum state, and then this atom ends up really being right or really being left, and I can't recover from that. But as long as I don't watch, or in other words, as long as I don't, even in principle, I'm not able to get information about the position of the atom, then the atom is still left and right at the same time. And if it is left and right at the same time, it still has the information to be able to go back to its original place. And that's exactly what we see here. Right. And I think this is seen here for the first time in like real space that you see this this happen. I can plot this. This is the position. This is the time. And you see how it pulses over and over in and out. So here the atoms are localized, then they are delocalized over 20 sites, and then they perfectly come back. And what amazed us really is that how perfect this is. I would have not expected this at all. So when my students showed me the pictures, I couldn't believe it. Because normally it's so easy to decohere quantum states. And that's the main problem for building quantum computer and so on and so on. Is that you always have decoherence. It's never perfectly controlled, but here we have really reached a degree of control that I wouldn't have thought possible. Okay, this is our one Lego piece. But one Lego piece, like one atom in this quantum world isn't that much yet. Let's see how we can put pieces together. How about two? if you have two atoms here, suddenly it matters what kind of atoms you have. But all that matters is actually if the atoms are so-called bosons or fermions. So this is a property that doesn't matter at room temperature at all. At quantum temperatures, it makes all the difference. Bosons are very friendly particles. They want to be together. Fermions hate each other. You will never find two indistinguishable fermions at the same position, lattice side. They want to strictly avoid each other. Let's see if you can see that in the experiment. Well, also the atoms interact with. They can also interact with one another. So let's start with bosonic statistics, okay? If you just have weakly interacting bosons, what we have for atoms, and we do the same quantum walk, we actually find that they always end up on opposite, they always end up on the same side. So this, in principle, a priori, there would be no reason why they always should end up at the same side. This even happens if they don't interact with one another. They don't feel each other, okay? But yet, they always end up on the same side. Two atoms left, two atoms left, two atoms left, two atoms right, okay? It's random where they are. I mean, they're really delocalized, right, before we take the picture. But it's more than that. There is some, just the fact that we have two particles fundamentally changed the position. Then it's not independent anymore. Now, why is that? The thing is, these two atoms, there's nothing in the world that can distinguish them. They are fundamentally indistinguishable particles. But this means if our initial state is two atoms next to each other, and our final state here, like if you ask how likely is it to find them on the same side, well, we cannot tell did they take the red path or did they take the green path. We fundamentally cannot tell that, okay? Because they're indistinguishable, because nothing in the world can tell two atoms apart, okay? But that means that you now have to think of this. There's one wave that describes the situation where both particles take the red path, and there's one wave that describes the situation that both particles took the green path. And for bosonic atoms, these two interfere constructively, just like what we had here. They interfere constructively for bosonic atoms if they are on the same side. Okay. If they're on the opposite side, you see that now this green path is two extra steps, and that makes all the difference. Two extra steps means the two waves will be out of phase, exactly. Okay. And that means that now these two possibilities, this way around or this way around, you can assign a wave to each of those processes, but they cancel out each other. Okay. So these two processes cancel out, and we will never see that happen. Okay. Well, this is bosons. So the spin of the atom determines if it's half-numbered or integer, whether it's a boson or fermion. For fermionic statistics, it's opposite. For fermionic statistics, you just swap the signs, because fermionic statistics means if you exchange two particles, that changes signs. So now you get destructive interference in this case and constructive interference in this case. Well, in any case, what you see is here now they're always on the opposite side. So it's very clean signature. I should mention right now these aren't real fermions. These are fermionized bosons, but this is a detail. What matters is that this is really the fermionic statistics here. And so now you can see that they always end up on the opposite side. And that's not because they repel each other, they push away. This is not because they push away from each other. It's really this quantum statistics, fundamental quantum interference that makes that happen. Okay. So this is two particles. Well, of course, as physicists, we try to study this in detail. So here are pictures, one position, this position of atom one, position of atom two. And this means that we always find them on the same side here and here, and never on opposite sides, right? And opposite here for the fermions. But all I want to show you is this is experiment and this is theory. So it's quite amazing. It tells you again how clean these systems are, and that you can really study. You can do a precision comparison between theory and experiment. Okay, we had one piece of Lego and one atom. Then we had two pieces of Lego, two atoms. Well, it should get a bit more interesting. So let's see if we can have many pieces of atom. And you see already, then we can make more complicated things that still have quite a bit of quantum weirdness. The idea here is that there is actually one quantum system that's not particularly accessible, but that is really quantum. And that is pretty much everything. I mean, pretty much each metal or a superconductor, for example. I'll show you one later. Those are the electrons in a piece of crystal. They behave quantum mechanically, okay? And inside a crystal, the electrons, they move around. So these are the crystal ions, and the electron is a gas of electrons moving around that crystal. And all these things I was telling, they do happen in each piece of material for the electrons, not for atoms. Okay, the electrons are much lighter, so and so then the de Broglie wavelength is like the wave packet size is larger. But of course, single electrons you don't have as good of a handle on. There are some nice experiments actually. For example, STM microscopy, like Jenny Hoffman, for example, here, who's in the audience. She does fantastic experiments with STM, where you look at these electron wave functions. Okay, but so this is real matter. What we can now build is artificial synthetic matter. We replace the quantum gas of electrons by a quantum gas of atoms, and then that quantum gas of atoms, this lives in this artificial crystal formed of light, that we call optical lattice. Okay. And then we can study all kinds of aspects. For example, one of the first things we did with the quantum gas microscope is to study a transition from a superfluid to a Mott insulator. This transition is a quantum phase transition, and that means it can even happen at absolute zero temperature where there are no thermal fluctuations anymore. Instead, this is really driven by quantum fluctuations, the kind of thing we do. In a superfluid state, each atom is delocalized over the whole lattice. So you have a big lattice with a million atom or 100,000 atom, and each particle initially is everywhere at the same time. The quantum state is this particle is everywhere, the next particle is also everywhere, the third particle is also everywhere. This is what happens if you load a Bose-Einstein condensate into such an optical lattice. Okay. Very counterintuitive, but also conceptually quite simple, actually, this state. It's actually related to what you would have, like a laser beam or so. But we were then able, if we make the atoms repel, then they go from this state where one atom is everywhere to a state where suddenly one atom is on each side, or there's exactly one atom per side. And they're not delocalized anymore, so from delocalized to localized. Or recently, we got a bit bored of looking at hopping atoms, and we wanted to see if we can do magnetism. Magnetism means that now we consider particles that are localized to lattice sites, that are placed particles that are placed on these lattice sites, and they have a little a spin, like a little magnetic moment. Imagine you have little compass needles, okay? And they interact with one another. They might want to align the same direction or anti-align or so, okay? But now let's do all of this with quantum spins, okay? And meaning that these spins can actually not just point in one direction, they actually point in different directions at the same time, just as the atoms were at different positions at the same time, these magnets can point in different directions at the same time. And And so there, for example, we studied the transition from a paramagnet when you, when you have a large external magnetic field, all these little spins, they would, all the little compass, quantum compass needles, they want to align with that external field and just all point in the same direction. But if you then reduce that field, if you go down here, then we would create an anti-ferromagnetic order. And this is exactly what we observed in the experiment. So we start with a large field where all the spins are aligned. And then if you reduce that field, we get a quantum phase transition to an anti-ferromagnet. And this means that, so these are, again, these independent 1D lines, but now with many atoms, and you see this pattern of dark, bright, dark, bright. The dark and bright here encodes the spin. So if it's bright, it's a spin or like a little compass needle pointing up. And if it's dark, it points down, okay? And so we can take these pictures directly and see these pictures. If you zoom in here, you see like chains of interferomagnetically ordered chains. Well, so why is this interesting? Well, remember again that these spins, they cannot just be up or down. They can also be up and down, okay, at the same time in the quantum superposition of up and down. But they're not independent. Like, you really can have a superposition. For example, the actual ground state here is up, down, up, down, up, down, plus everything the other way around, down, up, down, up, down, up. Or at this critical point, everything is really, every spin depends on every other spin. So this gets really rich, really complex, and there is a lot of interesting physics involved there. And of course, there are connections of this. This kind of thing can happen in real materials, and that's what we want to study, right? Or dislocation here. You have up, down, up, down, up, down, and then suddenly one spin is the wrong way, and the chain continues the other way. But this is like a quasi-particle that can actually be also at multiple, can be in a superposition of different positions. And so these are the kind of things we are starting to study. Okay. So you got a little bit of a flavor of that. So why why is that interesting? The interesting thing is that there's a really strong connection to what people do in condensed matter physics, meaning in physics where you try to understand materials, quantum materials, things like high-temperature superconductors. Let's try this real quick here. I can pour some liquid nitrogen in here. I have a little high-temperature superconductor. A superconductor is a conductor that loses all its resistance if it gets cold. Let's see. So there's it loses all its electrical resistance when it gets cooled below a critical temperature. You see, when it gets cold enough, then the magnet is so it's floating. The magnet is levitating on top of the superconductor. The reason is because the superconductor actually catches on to the flux lines of the magnetic field of the little magnet, and that makes the magnet float on top of the superconductor. But more importantly, this piece of material right now has absolutely zero electrical resistance. You can send any current through it without any loss. If you build a coil out of it, it creates a really strong magnetic field that never dies down until you warm it up again. Okay. Normally, the superconducting happens at very cold temperatures. You need liquid helium, very expensive to cool that. But people found, like Bednorz, found these high-temperature superconductor materials pretty much by coincidence 25 years ago, something like that. And so this has huge technical potential, but it turns out it is incredibly hard to understand them. It's still major open questions on how this piece of material actually works, because this is a very fine example of a really interesting quantum material. Okay, these things are even much more complex and clever and astounding than anything I have shown you what the atoms do. Like the electrons in here to do even much more amazing things than what the atoms did that you saw that they are in many places at the same time and so on. And the challenge is to understand what's going on in these kind of materials. And this to understand such materials is really hampered by our ability to calculate what's going on. There's a big gap in knowledge. You can do experiments, but oftentimes you just do kind of like random trial and error approaches to find new interesting materials. And then in theory, you can try to calculate what you would expect to happen. You can have a simplified model that captures the physics that that you want to see. The problem is that there's a huge gap, because even the simplest models are extremely hard to calculate. For example, Hubbard model, you just have fermionic particles on a grid, as simple as it gets. It's not really understood. And why is that? The problem are these quantum superpositions I was telling you about, or this kind of like one atom can be in many places, or for the spins can be in all kind of different orientations. And if you want to describe the quantum state, you have to keep track of all different possibilities. For a classical system, you can say, okay, my classical system is in one particular spin state at this time. For a quantum system, even to just for a computer to memorize the current state of the quantum system, it has to keep track of all possible permutations, all possible orientations of the spin. Okay. But that takes a lot of memory. How much memory does that take? Let's have a look. One of the best supercomputers can simulate 40 spins, 40. Okay, because it scales like 2 to the 40. Right. There are 2 to the 40 different ways you can arrange 40 spins. And so to just store the quantum state, you need 2 to the 40 memory cells, actually 2 to the 40 times 2 to the 40 memory cells. So how much better would the computer have to be if you want to go from 40 spins to a few hundred spins? Well, for example, each time you add one spin, your computer has to be twice as big. And well, let's compare this. So 2 to the 300, like for 300 spins, your computer needs more memory cells than there are protons in the universe. So clearly not doable. There's one bright there's one nice possibility is you can use a quantum computer to do that, because that is exactly inherent in a quantum system. You have this kind of, that's what inherent in a quantum system, and it has been shown that a quantum computer can help to solve such problems. The only problem is that the state of quantum computers is kind of where mechanical computers used to be 150 years ago or 200 years ago. So, well, to have the Lego analogy, this is a little mechanical computer that can solve a quadratic equation. Now, so that's not particularly far, and it will take a while until we see a universal quantum computer that can do it all. But Richard Feynman in 82 already had the idea, one quantum system can simulate another quantum system. If we build one quantum system that just is kind of acting the same as a different one that we want to understand, but this one we can have a better look, we can analyze better, then we have a real possibility to do some physics. So this is a Lego version of that. The idea is to have an analog, kind of an analog quantum computer. Not digital, not a computer that can do everything, but, well, what do you want to do with a quantum computer? The most interesting application, I think, is to solve condensed matter problems and to study physics rather than to hack codes or so. I don't know how you think, but interestingly, even regular computers started out that way, right? Because like 80 years ago or so, how did a rocket find its path initially, right? There were mechanical and mechanical analog computers inside there. Or here, for example, is a computer that can be programmed by putting wires in to solve complicated differential equations. That's what you had to do before computers got powerful enough to do so. So we are trying the same with these ultracold atom systems. We build a system that reflects a certain physical problem and then let the atoms do. Okay, that's the idea. And what can it help? Well, as I said, one of the applications, for example, you saw this high-temperature superconductor floating here. It happens that there is like a Hubbard model. The simplest possible model with fermions already has some interesting connections to that. It will not solve the high-temperature. Ultimately, it would be great to find better high-temperature superconductors. There could be superconductors that work at room temperature. We don't know, because we don't know what to look for, what to search for. But we won't be able to immediately answer that, but we hope that we can shed light by studying these models and trying to understand such quantum systems better, and so that ultimately maybe it will be possible to design materials at will. And this is what we do in our new experiment. So our second half of the group has just built a quantum gas microscope with lithium, and it's just about to work, I believe. Okay, so I showed you how we went from single atoms, where we saw quantum superposition and one atom being at many places. Then we went to two pairs, where we had a situation that two atoms indistinguishable. You really have to decide, are they bosons or fermions? And that brings in quantum statistics that makes it much more rich. But then you can have many places, you can have many atoms, more and more pieces together to build much more complicated synthetic matter, and ultimately you can really try to address open questions in theoretical condensed matter physics by using these quantum simulation. And yeah, so with that, let me thank my students, actually, first of all, who are here partially. So if you are here, stand up. Actually, thank you very much for all the work. And for the nice lab tour, I would also like to thank the funding agencies and donors, and which made that all possible. And and I would thank you. I would like to thank you very much for your attention.
I didn't get what fermions and bosons were.
Excuse me, can you say that once more?
I didn't get what fermions and bosons were.
What fermions and bosons are, wow. Yeah, that's complicated. So there are two. So the thing is that so particles have a property called spin that is that is given by a number, and that number can only be half or full. It can be 1, 2, 3, or 1/2, 1.5, 2.5. Okay, and the particle right, and that determines if it's a boson or fermion. If it's 1, 2, 3 spin, then it's a boson, and 1/2. The interesting thing is if you put two particles together, like 1/2 and 1/2, what is that together? 1, right? So 1/2 plus 1/2 is 1, and so then you can turn two of these fermions into one boson. And then if you have them behave quantum mechanically, the bosons love to be at the same place. They love to be together always. And the fermions, they really can't be together. They are loners. They want to be as far away as possible. And so, for example, what happens in the superconductor is that two of these 1/2 thingies called electrons, they go together and they form a so-called Cooper pair. So they two of these halves go together, and suddenly these Cooper pairs that are now have a spin of 1, they now want to be together. And together they form a big wave, and this big wave, this allows current to flow in a big wave, essentially, without resistance. Are there more questions? I'm sure.
So these real-time pictures you showed in the movie in the beginning, how did you take them without actually evaporating your atoms from the trap?
Right. So the thing is that as we take pictures of the atoms, so we start at 10 picokelvin or so, but as soon as one atom just scatters a single photon, it has been heated up by a million times to microkelvin. Okay. But we have made our lattice deep. We increase the depth of this lattice by a factor of 1,000 before we shine light on. We make it much deeper. And then we shine light on, and then we actually cool the atoms constantly so that they get really cold. We cool them as they scatter photons via laser cooling again. And so we can keep them in there, but they kind of go up and down the ladder of a harmonic oscillator on each lattice side, and so they behave quasi-thermal, and so they can move around just like a thermal atom without actually getting totally lost.
In your quantum gas microscope, do you use atoms other than lithium, and if so, which one?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, I did mention that at all. Actually, in all the atoms you saw were rubidium atoms. You can use lots of different species. It doesn't really matter. It just matters if they're bosons or fermions. It's actually kind of funny. The difference between a bosonic and fermionic species is one neutron more or less, so different isotope. Like, that doesn't make a difference in chemistry at all. For these ultracold temperatures, it makes all the difference. Okay? And so there are, for example, lithium. There's one isotope, lithium 6 and 7. 6 is a... is a fermion, 7 is a boson. That's what matters. But you can use many different species. People do lithium, sodium, like all the alkaline are easy because they are like hydrogen, just one electron flying around. But you can also do all the earth, all the transition elements, like erbium, dysprosium, strontium, ytterbium. There have been many elements that have been used by now.
So the hello?
Yeah.
So the two atom experiments in one dimensional, right? The Hopping. So
yes.
How do you create the difference between
We just make one we have a two-dimensional lattice, actually a three-dimensional lattice, and two directions we make very deep, so there's no hopping tunneling in that direction. And one is weak, so we can tunnel in that direction.
Yeah, but
the atoms can tunnel.
But then
in that
there shouldn't be any difference between boson and the fermion if it is just one-dimensional hopping.
Indeed, what I showed you were not real fermions. They were actually fermionized bosons. So they were strongly repulsive bosons, but the quantum statistics of that in the limit of a hardcore interaction is fermionic statistics. So we'll soon have real fermions in our new experiment.
What timescales do you have available to you in the laboratory? How mm-hmm. quickly do you have to work?
Yeah, excellent question, because the temperatures, what I said, 10 picokelvin or so, the temperature in units of time is actually hertz. Hertz temperatures, that means we have to do the experiment in within a second or so to be adiabatic, and that's indeed what we do. A typical experimental timescale is between 100 milliseconds and 1 second. Over which we can, yeah. But we can really keep, I mean, we can keep them cold for multiple seconds, and then very slowly we might lose a few atoms, or actually our main losses by atoms, the our vacuum still isn't perfect. There's still atoms flying around. Every once in a while they kick out one atom.
Why does the wave function collapse when you look at it classically?
because it has to, because once you know where the atom is, it can't be at many places at the same time anymore, right? Like this meta wave tells you the probability to find the atom at different positions if you look, or if you, I mean, it's not you as an observer look, it's like if you create the ability to tell where it might be, okay?
So to drag this to the macro world, the flyer for this said that you would describe new materials that could be made by putting the Lego blocks together. What might that be? What comes out of this?
So I'm not sure if there are new materials where like atoms are in superpositions, because for that, see, what I was showing you is a very extreme case where atoms are really at multiple places at the same time, and that's extreme. For that, you have to go to this picokelvin temperature or microkelvin or whatever. But the thing is that there's this analogy between what electrons do in an actual material and what our atoms do in our crystal made of light. It's this analogy that might help to ultimately create new materials, but then we're talking about the electrons moving in real materials that could have properties, for example, a superconductor at room temperature. With cold atoms, people have already created something like that would be, in that analogy, would be superconducting at room temperature, but it's not easy to transfer this, but this is one of the goals. Or interesting magnetic materials with anionic statistics, materials that will allow you to build quantum computers, the materials that allow you to store quantum information without it being perturbed, things like that. Or for measuring and metrology, for sensors, like if you sense something, often you work at the quantum limit, right? You really work at detecting photons in a camera for astronomy, that is really limited by the quantumness of the photons. And so there could be applications for metrology. Things like that.
Is it possible to use this device to study any portion of the fission or fusion type reactions?
Well, this is an interesting question. So not directly, you know, you cannot use cold. For that, you need high energies. We use extremely low energies. The question is an analogy. There is some kind of analogy, because what happens inside the nucleus of an atom is also something like a superfluid of these protons and neutrons. So we could maybe build a system that now consists of a few atoms in a little trap, and that will then behave in a similar fashion or in analogy to how protons and neutrons behave inside an atomic nucleus. So in that sense, maybe. But
thank you.
But only in this analogy. You cannot create cold fusion by cooling a lot or so. Also, yeah, right. And I should just as a comment, I mean, of course, I should say that this is not at all esoteric or weird or so. Like, we really have a good understanding why this, we know this to happen. We see it with electrons every day. This all makes sense. It's not like And you can be assured that you will never have a big piece of something at multiple places at the same time. No way. Because even if you just use a single atom, we need to get it to picokelvin temperature. If you wanted to have this at multiple places, you would have to have it at, I don't know, like 100 orders of, just absolutely impossible. So it's, we are all safe there.
If I could follow, there's no such thing as the much colder you get, the less critical mass you need. Mm-hmm.
So I was wondering, why exactly are you limiting yourself to atoms and rather any smaller particles? Because technically, when it comes to quantum aerodynamics, we look at very like the particles that make up the atom, like the quarks, the gluons, and everything like that.
Right. So there's a hierarchy of energy scales. Like once you start with quarks and gluons and so on. This all happens at much higher energy. And in a way, for example, if in a supercollider you smash together atoms and they, or just protons, and they fly apart, there is similar quantum mechanics happening inside that. It's just that if you use these elementary particles, or if you use these smaller particles, then the physics happens at much higher energy. They are mutually exclusive. Well, there are some interesting things. So one can think about, instead of using atoms, you could use, for example, positronium, like one electron and one positron, or muonium, like one muon and another I forgot what they use, but there are some interesting experiments where you instead of using atoms, you use combinations of different particles, and that is actually that has some, that might have some very interesting applications. We don't, but there are because to create those particles, you need colliders. So you have to work at CERN or so. But for example, Jerry Gabriels here in the department, he works with anti-hydrogen. Okay, so they go to CERN, they take a positron, which is the anti-particle of an electron. And an anti-proton that they can make at this at the big collider, they put that together to form anti-hydrogen, and then in principle they could make a Bose-Einstein condensate of that. Except there are some other problems to overcome first.
Thank you. So you know there was this one graph you were talking about where this breathing property that you called it. Where the atom was localized at one place and then it had this wave function, but then why would you expect it to come back? I think that in this breathing property.
Right. So I would like so in terms of the wave function, you mean like why if you place a wave function like this, why does it beat like this? The wave function itself. Unfortunately, I don't have a particularly good intuitive picture for that. I was thinking about that. Normally, you think in momentum space, and then I don't have a particularly good picture. It has to do with Bragg reflection, that this wave that matters out kind of gets reflected and comes back. That's one way to kind of think of it, but I haven't found a particularly good intuitive. It's very simple math. If you just write down what you expect to happen with such a wave, you can do the same with light. Okay, if you make an array of optical fibers that are coupled with one another, you get the exact same. You feed light into one optical fiber, it spreads out over many, it comes back to one. It spreads out over many, it comes back to one. People actually have recently done that, right? And there's a great analogy you can, in principle, do with photons. You can do the same as we do with atoms. You have the same kind of effects happening. The difference is our atoms, they can interact very strongly with one another. With photons, that is very hard to do.
Should we thank the speaker again? And you can come down and ask questions afterwards. But let's thank Mark.